Good afternoon. Let's try that one more time. Good afternoon. My name is Andy Nixon. I am Senior Pastor of First Methodist Houston. Thank you for coming out to our noon Good Friday service here downtown. Good Friday, of course, is when we remember the crucifixion of Jesus and his death on the cross. And it's never an easy day to walk into or an easy day to worship in. Yet, I always believe that what is coming means so much more to us when we enter into the suffering of this week, and particularly today. So thank you all for being here on Good Friday. A bit of housekeeping, just to remind you that Sunday we will have our services as usual, 8:45 here downtown at 11 o'clock. We look forward to seeing many of you there. Also, if you do just want to stay in the worship spirit tonight at 7:30 over on our West Campus, we will have a Good Friday service led by our Source team, which is our contemporary worship team. And it's a very powerful evening that they have planned for us. And so if you're available, we would love to see you there. But thank you so much for coming to be with us this afternoon. If you would allow me, let us begin in prayer. Pray with me. Jesus, we thank you for this day, and this day of all days in the year is one that is simply difficult to approach you on. We know of your love for us. We know of your grace. We know that your arms are always open to us, as we will hear in your word. Even on your last breaths, you were inviting people to know you. Yet we also know, Jesus, there's a sinful side to us. And in that darkness is the source of what led us to put you on that tree. And so we ask, Jesus, that you would help us to see both sides of ourselves, the one that wants to embrace you and to follow you and to shout Hosanna on a Palm Sunday. Also help us to see within us the darkness, which is not so pleasant. But if we're just to be honest with you, Lord, we confess that there is part of us that doesn't want to know you and in fact wants to run the other way and resist. So we ask, Jesus, that you would work in us to save what is good, to redeem what is far from you, and to change us, so that because of our time together in your presence this day and this holy week, we might find ourselves more the creation you intended us to be. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, and as his people we say together, amen. Let's stand, let's sing.
Thank you. Let's pray. Holy God, this is the day where love and sorrow meet in such a unique and powerful way. Jesus, you willingly suffered for us. It is difficult to pray anything today except the words, thank you. We are, however, mindful that this love that is so amazing and so divine demands our souls, our life, and our all. And so today we are aware that the best possible place to put our worries, our cares, and the suffering of the world around us is in your nail-scarred hands. And so hear us as we pray this day. We pray for the church, that we may bear our cross and follow Jesus. We pray for those who have sinned like Peter, who in thought, word, or deed denied knowing you. Teach us to be sorry for our sins and forgive us. We pray for prisoners and criminals like Barabbas. May they find their true freedom in you. And may we find our true freedom in you when we are imprisoned by the things of this world. We pray for people in government like Pilate. May they lead with integrity and value justice. We pray for those who are dying like the thieves who died with Jesus. May they die with Jesus by their side and be received into your kingdom. We pray for parents like Mary who have lost a child, for friends like Mary Magdalene who grieve a loved one. May they know the comfort of your love. We pray for the whole human race that we may all come to know the Lord Jesus as our Savior. Holy God, as we gaze upon your cross today, we pray that the suffering and death of Jesus may come to lighten the load of all who suffer. Lead us in the way of the cross so that as we suffer with Jesus, we may rise to life in his glory. We pray this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourself and crucify him. I find no case against him." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified.
Thank you. Two others also were criminals, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing.
Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing.
Amen. one of the criminals who was hanging there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise.
Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home.
Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby. He said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother."
Jesus,
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
At about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," that is, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Every time we gather in Holy Week, one of the questions I ask myself is, how could this go so wrong? And that we go from Palm Sunday, where Jesus is entering in Jerusalem and he has his followers waving palm branches and people are shouting literally from the streets, "Hosanna, Hosanna, this is the one who is to come in the name of the Lord, Hosanna." And in oh so short a time, things change. And you say, how in the world could things go so wrong so fast? I think there are a lot of answers to that question. And that in the events of Holy Week, one of the things that will happen is that Jesus will do some things that gets the attention of powers that be. And those powers that be will unite at a little difficulty and after some conversations and some betrayal and some bribery to coalesce to say, we need to kill this man from Nazareth. And as I think about that and the kind of scripture as it tells the story, one of the things that occurs to me is that the powers that be function so differently than the example Jesus set for us. The Roman authorities want Jesus to go away because he is disturbing the peace. In a political sense, the Romans, as they moved east, they would allow people like Herod the Great, King Herod in our Bible, they would allow him to be the ruler, but it was on two conditions. One, that he send as much money as he could to Rome, and the other was that he would keep the peace. Pontius Pilate was there to make sure Herod did that, and if Pontius Pilate did not do his job, Rome would remove him. As an aside, a few years later, Rome did that to Pontius Pilate. He was banished because he could not keep the peace in the area of Jerusalem. There were other people inside the temple who also wanted Jesus gone. Jesus, one of the things that he would do is he would storm the temple with his followers watching, and he would go to the money changers in the temple, which was, as we talked about last week here at First Methodist, the source of an unbelievable amount of bribery and corruption. And he would throw the tables over and say, "This has no place in my Father's house." How could that not catch the attention of Caiaphas, the chief priest, the Sanhedrin, the ruling council of the temple and the Jewish authorities to say, "This man is nothing but trouble. We need to see that he would go." And sometimes we think, and scripture doesn't tell us all the details of a very complicated story, but sometimes we put the blame on Judas and say that it was in his heart, because of his darkness, that he decided to betray Jesus. And there is some of that that is true. But I wonder if in the inner sanctum of the temple, a deal was worked out to say, let's put the word out on the street that we've got 30 pieces of silver for anybody who will turn him in. And they laid the trap that Judas then fell into. So many things were moving forces against Jesus that lead to his death and his crucifixion. One of the things that I notice as I read the scriptures is that there were so many labels that are put on people in this drama that is Holy Week. And we think of, you know, Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor. We think of Herod, who is the local ruler. We think of the Sanhedrin, the office of the leading council of the Jews. And they are also trying to put labels on Jesus. Are you the king of the Jews? And Jesus, rather almost seemingly nonchalantly to us, says, if you so are the one that so says it, doesn't take the label. And that's because I think that was so counter to who Jesus is. In the sense that, you know, Jesus, when he saw the woman who had committed adultery, he didn't see the woman who committed the offense. He saw the child of God that she was and is. When Jesus saw the leper, he didn't see his condition. He saw the man and the child of God that he is and could be. When Jesus saw his disciples, when he first called them, or when he saw some act of faithlessness on their part, like when they're arguing about which amongst us is going to sit next to your right hand, Jesus, in heaven, which one of us is going to have the most important place. Jesus had to be, I'd like to think, some sense irritated at their teenager-like antics. Yet I also know he saw through that and say, these 12, these are going to be leaders for us. They are going to change. They are going to grow. They are going to carry this message forward. And in time, they indeed did. Jesus saw the person, not the condition or the label. I was in Haiti several years ago, and I remember it was my first time to go to Haiti on a mission trip, working with an organization there, the worst poverty that I had ever seen. And as I'm walking in these villages with dirt streets and mud shacks and thatch roofs, and I see children with orange hair and bloated bellies because of malnutrition, the first thought I have is I see the condition and not the kid. We do the same thing. We think about the labels that we see, the conditions that we have, the person that they are eludes us. And so a challenge for us on this Good Friday would be to see, let's see the full person in one another. In ourselves, when we look at the mirror, let's not be so quick to say what we're not, or to put on ourselves, you know, all of our flaws. Let's see the child of God that Jesus sees. I wonder if we could do that with each other. A little way you can try is and say, when you see somebody or you're talking to somebody, use their name, their first name. And as you use their name, just in a back of your mind kind of way, pray for that person. And as you pray for that person, maybe what can happen is your prayers, of course, matter. But also that prayer changes you, and we see the person in the fullest sense of the word as Jesus would. When we act that way, I think we are so much more Christ-like than we could be if we were more shallow. I mean, let's be honest. Our culture loves labels. We put them on people right and left, conservative, liberal, progressive, this, issue, that, office, this. We love them. We stick them on everybody that we possibly can. And sometimes we do it so much, we forget that these people have a name. Have you ever seen a car around town where it's somebody who loves bumper stickers? You know, there are all sorts of causes, and the whole car of the back of the car is just plastered in bumper stickers so that it's almost the stickers that are holding the car together. Somewhere under that, though, is a car, right? And it's got a name and a type and a brand. We can't treat people the same way in the sense that we put so many labels on them, we forget who they are on the inside. So maybe a challenge to us on this Good Friday is, you know, my guess is today when you got up, you went through your morning routine, whatever that is. Many of you have been at work, and maybe that will resume after this service. But maybe between now and Easter, there's some things that we could do. Like, don't turn on your TV. In fact, maybe throw it away. That could be one of the holiest things we consider doing in our modern time. Maybe think about people by first name, instead of being somebody at the office who has this job or that job. If you're a higher up person, maybe take the time to learn the maintenance staff's name between now and Easter morning. And if there's somebody else that you would not normally have the chance to know, maybe it's a good day to reach out a hand and say a prayer. You see, because I think Jesus saw fully the person, whoever it was that he encountered. And one of the tragedies of Good Friday and Holy Week is that those in power in Jesus' day, earthly power, did not. All they saw was an instigator. They saw a threat. They saw a protester. They didn't see a healer. They didn't see a teacher. They didn't see a miracle worker. They just saw someone who is going to change things. And in their opinion, they made the conclusion for the worst. I like to think that they could have changed their path. I like to think that they could have repented of their thoughts. I like to think things could have turned another way, but they did not. And so at the end of the day, after we had run down this evil road to the fullest extent that we could, God said no. And in that, in between now and Sunday, our thoughts would do well, I think, to additionally turn inside and say, what is it within us that's running from God? What is it within us that is resisting? What is it within us that doesn't want to speak the truth, even though we live in times where the truth needs to be cried out? And as we encounter these forces of darkness within us, as we encounter evil around us, it's a time to confess, to repent, but also get ready to move forward. Because God never allows for evil and death and darkness to have the final word. And in the time between our tragedy and crucifying Jesus and Sunday morning, now we will wait. But let's not wait just idly. Let's also get ready. For when God speaks God's word to say, this will not stand, he's going to need some people to move. And those of us who spend this time between Friday and Sunday well will be those people who, when God speaks, they will hear and be ready to answer. Pray with me. Lord, we thank you for this difficult day. Following you means we follow you on the days that are blessings. What a great day it would have been to hear your teachings, your parables. What marvelous days those would have been. To see you entering Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, what a glorious day. Yet, Jesus, we also do not want to be people who follow you only when it's easy. But on this day, this Good Friday, and on all the difficult days, for there will be others to come, we pray that you would help us to stay faithful, being the kind of disciple that you have called your people throughout all time to be. All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, and as God's people, we say together, amen.
After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on the branch of a hyssop and held it to his mouth.
Jesus knew that everything was now finished, and to fulfill the scriptures, he said, "I am thirsty."
Thank you. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished."
It is finished.
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, when the sun's light had failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last.
Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last.